The title is really funny. You don't really know what it's, the whole talk is about. I hope everybody of you reads the abstract. So you might have seen the talks last year, which were about the new flexible indexing in Lucene 4.0. This year is also a little bit related to that, but hopefully Lucene 4.0 will come out in the next 3 months. Maybe I'm not 100% sure, but I'm confident that this will happen. So the 4.0 branch is already started, so the trunk development can proceed. So we are now on releasing it. And in Lucene 4.0 are a lot of new API changes. So that means Lucene 4.0 is no longer backwards compatible from the code side. So if you upgrade your code to Lucene 4.0, you have to change a lot of stuff. And one of those is maybe you have to re-implement some special, more internal Lucene structures because there were some changes in Index Reader, and this talk is about that. So the first is my background. I'm in the project management committee of Apache Lucene and Solar. And my main focus is on the Lucene development. So I'm also fixing some bugs in Solar, but most of the time I'm working on Lucene. I'm the guy who implemented the numerical search Solar users also know. So you can use it for fast geographic searches and all that stuff. So I'm working as a consultant for a company which is called SD Data Solutions. And my main task is, you heard it's about numerical search, is maintaining Pangea, which is a publishing network for geoscientific and environmental data. Yeah, and this is the agenda. So the first part is motivation, history of Lucene. In the second part, I will talk about those new replacements for Index Reader, which are called Atomic Reader and Composite Reader. A little bit later, I will come back to reader context, something I think most people were annoyed of when Lucene 2.9 came out. But with Lucene 4.0, that problem is fixed with the reader context. So it's really hairy to understand, but maybe I can show you. And finally, I have a wrap up. So. The first slide is about the general Lucene index structure. In the talk from Michael Busch before, he already showed you how an inverted index works in general. So you have the term index, posting list, and all the stuff. So the important thing for this talk is that a Lucene index does not consist of one single index. It has a different structure. So, and this allows it to support document additions. So it's possible, Lucene was the first search engine that allowed to add documents, not only in bulks. So it was possible that you can add a new document at any time later, commit it to the index, and then reopen your index searches and use and find the new document. Before Lucene, in most search engines, you had to re-index your whole stuff into a new index if you want to change something. And together with that, we have a snapshot isolation, which ensures consistency. And to implement that one, Lucene has a segmented index structure, which means whenever you commit something to the index, it creates a new segment. And this is a very old picture from Doug Cutting when he released the first version of Lucene. It shows very simplistic how this per segment structure works. So in the earliest Lucene versions, it was at that time, it was in fact every single document was a separate index. When you started to index one document, it created one index which only contained this one document with all this inverted inverted fields, means a term, dictionary, posting lists. So when you index more and more documents, of course, you get a lot of more indexes. So at some time, you have so many files on your hard disk that you have to merge them. So what happens is it starts to open those smaller indexes and creates while you are indexing new documents, it creates new segments. And here in this example, it always merges three segments to a new one. And finally, if you have too many segments again, it merges again. This is controlled by the merge policy. And in fact, when you open an index on disk, you see a lot of files on disk. And here in that case, this generation of the index has four segments, which is this one with 9 documents, one with 3 documents, and then 2 smaller ones with 1 document. So, and this is somehow a view on this index. So, if you optimize an index, it merges all those segments into one big segment. And this was called optimized before a change in Lucene 3.5, because optimize is not in all cases optimal. So optimized was important in early Lucene versions. In newer Lucene versions, you don't need to optimize at all. So because of that, we renamed that method. So that's false. If somebody tells you you have to optimize your index, you should not do that in most cases, unless you have some special requirements for statistics and all this stuff. So this is here some example how this merging works. This one is indexing Wikipedia, and you see here it creates those small segments. New segments are coming, and whenever there are too many segments, they are merged together to a new segment. And it takes some time. You see here it's quite fast, so it's a little bit faster, but it already merged 7 gigabytes. And so you see here merging is very intensive on your I/O system. So you might know if you have an index and start to optimize it, it creates a lot of I/O because it has to read all those files, decode them, and write it to a new segment again. So in most cases, you should simply trust the Lucene internals to merge those segments. So up to Lucene version 3.6, each segment, so that's still true in newer versions, each segment of such an index is a separate index, so you can execute a query on each segment on separate. So in Lucene 3.6, this is implemented by the class SegmentReader, which is public, I think, but only for experts. So you should not start to work with it if you don't know what you're doing. So each segment reader simply implements this index reader interface, and you can execute the query on it. And Lucene, as I said, an index on disk consists of more than one segment, so you have these composite indexes. And in Lucene 3.6, the internal class directory reader, which is returned when you open the index on disk, so it's an internal class, you don't see it, it's package private, that provides an interface onto the index on disk, in a way that it looks like a single index, but in fact it's not a single index. And there's also this other class multi-reader. You might know when you have several indexes on disk and you want to search all of them, you can use this multi-reader, which also does the same. It emulates a single index with one posting with one term dictionary and one posting list interface for this index. So, as I told you, the term dictionary is merged on the fly. So that means when you have an index that consists of more than one segment, of course, if you want to look up some term, you have to do this in all those subsegments and from the beginning throw away all those segments which does not have the term. And when you find the terms in those sub-indexes, you have to look up the postings and append them somehow. And also add some document offsets to get a global unique document ID. So this is done on the fly while executing the query. So you have here, for example, something if you're working the term dictionary, that's, for example, done when you execute a range query in Lucene. A range query is something where you said, I want to have all terms between, for example, term number 4 and term number 8, then it starts to iterate all those terms. and executes the query and returns the results for it. So in that case, this is an internal Lucene structure. Almost every query works on top of that structure. The term dictionary is exposed as a term enumeration. And when you have several indexes here, so you have one segment and another segment with different term dictionaries, you have to, when you walk through the term dictionary and you want to create the view on top of that, you need to manage priority queue of all the top-level terms you are currently sitting on, so you can choose the next term that you have to return in your enumeration, which is like an Java iterator. So when you iterate the term dictionary on an composite index in Lucene before 3.6, it's very expensive because you have to do this management of the priority queue all the time. So the lookup of terms is quite fast, but something like term dictionary, so iterating all terms is horribly slow, and you need that, for example, if you want to get the facets in Zola because you have to enumerate all the terms you find. So this is really expensive. And so the problem here is that's an overhead, and because of that, in early Lucene versions, it was recommended to you that you optimize your index, because by that, you don't have that overhead for merging the term dictionary on the fly. So those composite indexes also have some additional metadata. They expose the stored fields, term vectors, and deletions. So when you delete a document, it's marked as deleted. So it delegates, for the deletions, term vectors, and stored fields, it translates the document IDs you have on your top-level index reader to the document ID inside the segment. So that by that, it is possible to retrieve the document after you got the search results and display it to the user. There's also something with the field cache in Lucene 3.6. You have very often duplicate instances of the field cache, because whenever you change something in one of those sub-indexes, you have to reload the whole field cache, which are the uninverted fields, which means you have the values per document. And that's another problem you have. So when you reopen your index after you did some real-time updates, before Lucene 2.9, in that case, you had to reload the whole field cache, and that can take up to 10 seconds, depends on the size of your index. So that's really hard. So because of that, I already talked about that. So you have the queries are executed on an atomic view on the composite index, as I explained to you. At the moment, you have a slowdown for these multi-term queries, which are range queries, wildcard queries, fuzzy queries, all those queries looking at a lot of different terms. So the recommendation before Lucene 2.9 was to optimize your index in all cases. And I know a lot of Zola code always they're committing 5 documents and then they're starting to call the commit. The optimize method, which is the worst you can do somehow. So but at that time, it was really important. And on every index change, you have to reload the field cache. So in Lucene 2.9, the whole thing changed. So this is the main search method inside index searcher. So that's when you execute the query, this method, it looks almost like that. It's executed. So we no longer look at this view on the top-level index, we directly execute the query on each segment on its own. So if you have a term query, the term query is executed on every segment of your index, and then the results are simply collected. So in that case, it's done in order, so that means it goes from one subreader to the next one. It always calls this collector method. After that, you collect the results, for example, in the top docs. And so but the good thing with that is, so you don't need the live term dictionary merging. So you would simply execute the range query or fuzzy query, wildcard query on each segment on its own and simply merge the results. And the good thing is you can also parallelize that. So since Lucene 3.1, you can pass an executor service to the index searcher. So it can do the search on the parallel segments on the segments in parallel. And of course, another reason, don't optimize your index, because in that case you won't be able to parallelize the whole thing. The other thing is, for sorting, I was talking about the field cache only needs a per segment field cache. So when you add new documents, you're never changing or touching the segments which are already written to disk unless you merge them. So you get simply a new segment on your index, and all you need for sorting is to create the field cache for that single small segment. So reopening after real-time updates is very fast because of that. The same applies to filters. If you are caching your filters, like for example some bounding box filters, if you're doing Geo search, you can cache those filters per segment. And if you reopen your index after adding documents, it's very cheap to change those cached filters. But there are also some cons, though. There are some changes in the query and filter API which annoyed a lot of people in Lucene 2.9, because when you write your own filter or scorer, you have the problem that the document IDs your filter have to select are no longer on the top-level index reader. They are only on the segment you are working at the moment. So when executing the search query or the filter, you only see the small segment, but you don't have the view on the whole index anymore. That means, for example, if you're implementing something like a duplicate filter, you have no chance anymore to look into the other segments if there might be a duplicate document that you have to remove. So that's one thing, and I hope it's solved. This will be the last point today. And the other thing is, if you're sorting by string terms, and a lot of Solr users are doing that, because only string sorting allows it, even if you have numerical values, allowed it in the past to have missing values, because the problem is with the field cache on the native types, you have the problem they are all represented by zero if they are missing value, and then the sorting is always fucked up. So, but that's solved since Lucene 3.4 in a little bit of buggy way, but since Lucene 3.5, if you're doing native sorting by integer, float, or other fields, the field cache is used and it respects deleted documents or documents without a value. But the problem is, you still need to sort by some string value. When you are going from one segment to the next one, you need some string comparisons between the segments, because if you are only working inside one segment, Lucene uses an optimization to don't need to compare the string values. It only has something like the complete term dictionary, which every term has a number, and you know if the number of the term is smaller, it's also a smaller term. So sorting is that. But those term dictionaries are different between those segments, so that's no longer possible if you move from one to the next segment. So if you're doing a lot of string sorting, it might be useful to optimize your index, but you have to try that out. So now I come to Lucene 4.0, because in Lucene 4.0 we go one step forward and change everything to make this new concept of per segment search much better to understand and usable and type safe. So this is again a composite index on Lucene 3.6 when you open it from disk. So you have on-the-fly merged term dictionary, you have a posting list are merged, appended, you have the metadata, document frequencies, you have stored fields, term vectors, deletions, and you have the field cache maybe on the top-level reader, depends on your query. So I also only know Solr always have top-level field cache until some recent versions. So that's the problem. And with Lucene 4.0, we removed all that. So, and in Lucene 4.0, you have no longer a view, for example, on the term dictionary, posting lists, deletions, or the field cache on the top-level index reader. You can only work on the segments anymore, so it's no longer possible to look up a term on the top level index reader. It's still possible, but with a slowdown, you have to wrap something. I will come back to that later. So the only thing on a composite index, the only thing you can do is you can get the stored fields to display your search results. So, and because of that, in Lucene 4.0, early versions, my talk last year, was because of that, you know, all these methods in index reader where you get the term docs and term enumeration and whatever. The problem was in Lucene 4.0, for the user-facing APIs, if you call term enumeration on your index reader that you open from disk, it's wrote unsupported operation exception. Not very useful because you don't know, does this index reader support now term dictionary or not? So the problem was, it's a real old interface since Lucene 1.0, this index reader. So we have the problem, we kept it until the last day with all the problems. So in every query score or filter, we had to add some code to check if the index is really a segment, an atomic index, we call it now atomic index, or is it a composite index? So that was one of the problems. And at the end of last year, we started with, this is a well-known term on the Lucene mailing list, heavy committing. I think I started it 2 years ago. So I think it was at the time of 2.9 when I removed all the deprecations. I said, I'm just heavy committing at the moment. And since that day, whenever we change the whole Lucene API and millions of tests have to be changed, it's always heavy committing. So that was a funny part. So Eclipse was happy with refactoring and all that stuff. So what we did in Lucene 4.0, we split up those classes for the index reader. So we have a very most generic interface, which is index reader, as you all know. It's a superclass of more specific types. And the important thing is you cannot subclass index reader on yourself because it has a hidden constructor, so it's impossible to subclass it. And you should not do that because it would never work. Because you only have two actual implementations of that you can use. Any other index reader would not make sense in the Lucene world. So this is index reader is just an interface or an abstract class that has a very basic view on an index. It does not know anymore anything about inverted indexes. It has no terms, no postings. It allows access to stored fields, so you can still open an index searcher, execute a query using this index reader on top of it, so index searcher will handle that internally, what to do. But you can still display your search results because you have access to the stored fields, because that is very cheap. You only have to do some lookup and get the information. And it has some very limited metadata, as you all know, the number of documents, maximum document number, and all that stuff. So that's very basic. For a simple search application, that's all enough you need to know. Index reader did not change if you have the simple loop. Very important with Lucene 4.0 is index readers are now real index readers. I say readers because you can no longer modify an index reader. So you cannot delete any documents using the index reader and you cannot change norms anymore. This was possible in the past, but this was horrible because the code was very complicated and also had some multi-threading issues. So it's no longer possible to change anything with index reader. You have to use index writer to do that. And this applies to all readers in Lucene 4.0. And you can, of course, pass it to index searcher and just as before, and it also gives you the well-known index reader open for backwards compatibility, but it's deprecated. This is one of the seldom APIs in Lucene 4.0 which are explicitly deprecated because we wanted to keep some bit of backwards compatibility for the most common use case. So somebody using the Lucene Action Book and trying to compile the code does not completely fail when doing that. That's one thing. So another class we have is Atomic Reader, which is what you currently know from the index reader, which is an atomic view. It inherits from index reader, and it has access to atomic indexes, which means the segments of a multi-segment index. It could also be a custom implementation, whatever, or some filter. So it's in fact, it's a single segment. So it has a full term dictionary and postings API, so you are only able to execute queries on the atomic reader. And this is a new API of Lucene 4.0. So term enum and all those classes with an inconsistent interface, sometimes you have to call next first or next at the end, is no longer so. You have a four-dimensional API. You can enumerate all fields. You have term dictionaries, and then you have the term enumeration for this single atomic segment. And then, as shown in the talk by Michael Busch, you get the document numbers, and for each document, you get the positions, payloads, and all that stuff. And new in Lucene 4.0 is also access to doc values, which is a new field type in Lucene 4.0, which is a replacement for the field cache. So those are values, a single value per document, where you can sort against, for example. So it's no longer needed to uninvert your complete index just to sort against a field. You can simply declare that field as a doc values field, and then it's written to disk in a way that it can be random accessed, so you can sort easily. Then we have another class, which is a base class of the index reader you all know when you do index reader open, which is composite reader. It has, in fact, no additional functionality on top of index reader, so you can only get stored fields. But it provides one method, get sequential subreaders. This method might want to be protected in the near future because there are some restructuring going on. Coming to the last slides. It is to retrieve all child readers, which might not be atomic. So if you have a multi-reader on several indexes on disk, you would have a multi-reader on top, and then its child readers would be the directory readers, as I told, for those index directories on disk. And inside those directory readers are then the atomic readers. So get sequential subreaders returns that. And as said before, directory reader is the class when you open an index on disk, you have to use a new class directory reader, which was hidden before in Lucene. Now it's public. It's still abstract, and multi-reader implement this class. So every directory reader and multi-reader, so every index you're working with in your everyday work is a composite reader. Directory reader is changed to be abstract. It defines the interface for accessing on-disk indexes. It allows you to do all those stuff index reader could also do at the moment, but which was very specific to directories, which means you can ask the reader for commit points, index metadata, like the commit information, the version. You can ask it for, if it is current, for reopening. Directory reader is the only index reader class that now implements the reopen logic, which was renamed in Lucene 3.4, I think, to open if changed. So when your index have changed, you can reopen it to get a new directory reader instance, which only those segments that really changed be visible. So it's something like cheap reopen. And the important thing with directory readers is the child readers are always atomic readers. In that case, they will be implemented by the internal class segment reader, as in all Lucene versions before. It also provides the static methods. I told you this index reader dot open is deprecated, but those are the well-known methods. So in fact, when you open an index, you should use directory reader dot open to open your index. And implemented is the whole thing you're using in your everyday work using standard directory reader, which is hidden to the outside, which is the actual class implementing it. So this is the basic search example. So it looks familiar. I think you already know that. So you're calling, the only change here is you're calling directory.open. The rest of this code is identical to before. So no real change. So this is an often asked query on the mailing list. Yeah. So I still need terms and postings. For example, I want to calculate some facets or do some auto-completion or whatever. So what should I do? Should I optimize my index? Yeah, okay, what should I do? So the first thing is most people should simply calm down and think a little bit about their problem. So the first thing is maybe take a break and drink a beer. This is the solution of Robert Mir. I think he is also here, maybe. Yeah. And the second thing is don't optimize your index. It would not help you because on an optimized index, you still get back a composite reader with only one segment. So, but there's so the efficient solution is to get the subreaders and do, as I told before, execute your problem on every segment reader on itself. So there's this nice utility method, which is called reader get top reader context leaves, which gives you all atomic leaves of those index reader, and you can then do your work, maybe parallelized, and you merge your results. And there's also another solution which is not really recommended because of that. It has a strange name, slow composite reader wrapper. So you can pass in any index reader, and what it does, it emulates, as told before, using those on-the-fly merging of term dictionary and posting lists, so you can get an index reader that works as slow as before. Without those optimizations, and internally, this index reader is also used for merging segments, because when you merge those segments, you have to merge the term dictionaries. And if you're a Solr programmer, because this one would create a new instance on every call, so you can get it from the Solr index searcher directly, you can get atomic reader, so for easy usefulness. The reason behind that is that a lot of Solr code is up to now not yet working per segment. That's one of the problems why this is so prominent in Solr. So there are some other readers, like filter atomic reader, which is the old filter reader. There's also parallel atomic reader and parallel composite reader. So you might simply look into those. They are all useful for specific use cases. Index reader reopening only works on directory readers anymore. There's no more reopen for atomic readers or multi-readers or parallel or filter reader. So when you want to reopen your index, you have to do that with the directory reader and then start to wrap it again. So the last one is, I will do that very quickly, I hope I have 5 minutes or something like that, is about the reader context, which is one of the problems of Lucene 2.9. When you look at the new API and the scorers and search APIs, you see now index reader context, atomic reader context, or composite reader context, and then you think, what the fuck is that? I have no idea. What should I do with that? You also have seen those that method before, which I called get top reader context. So the problem, as I told before, was if you have a structure of those indexes. So, for example, you see here you have a directory reader with a lot of documents, but this directory reader consists of more than one segment. And then you wrap those directory readers again with a multi-reader on top of that. So you have a composite reader on all those index readers. So you have here, in fact, 6 different atomic readers, and all those atomic readers start their document IDs at position 0. So the first document is always position 0. So when you execute the search on every single atomic reader, you only have the document IDs of those single small indexes. But the problem is, I told you, for example, something like duplicate filter, it might be possible to look into another segment to access the information, is this document not duplicate? So if it's a duplicate, I have to hide it in my filter or something like that. So that was not possible since 2.9, and even in 3.6, it's not possible to implement this duplicate filter. It's still broken. in Lucene. So to have that information, whenever you execute a filter or query in Lucene, there are some tricks. So what happens, for example, here, if you have this directory reader in the past, you would get this directory reader and it would have those document numbers. But the problem is if you have look on top of that, you have different document IDs. So what you cannot do is you cannot store inside your index reader something like an offset. That's impossible because you can use the atomic reader on its own or you can wrap them as you like. So it's not possible. So the most important thing is we cannot save the information about the reader tree in the index readers itself. And because of that, there's a parallel structure to that which are called the index reader contexts. And this is what Index Searcher is doing. It gets a get top reader context. And this context view provides you a view on all the childs an index reader has. So when you have a multi-reader with several directory readers consisting of tons of segment readers, you get something like a view on top of that. And for each segment, you get the information from the viewpoint of this top-level reader, what the document IDs are. So when you execute your query, you can, for example, then using the reader context, walk up the query tree and look into another segment and check if there's a duplicate for your document, for example. Or if you are faceting to look if the term is also in some other document. So that's now possible because you get the information. And then the change is that each reader context has a doc base, and when you execute a query in the index reader, it passes a so-called atomic reader context to your filter, where you can get the information about the top-level reader and all this information you might need to execute the query. Yeah. So, and that's I think it's the final thing. So. Just a summary, so in Lucene moved to per segment search in Lucene 2.9. In Lucene, until Lucene 3.6, all indexes are still accessible from any hierarchy level with the same interface, so you can get posting lists, but that might be slow. So if you're writing some very old code and you have non-optimized indexes, it could be very slow. If you don't do it per segment, and with Lucene 4.0, we split those index reader classes into several abstract interfaces to have a type safety on if this is an atomic reader or composite reader and what you can do with them. And finally, which is new, which solves the problem of Lucene 2.9 with the per-segment search are the index reader contexts, which give you some overview about your top-level query when executing it on a single segment. Yeah.